You know, there weren't many days in my childhood where I didn't at some point act like one of my heroes. I mean, I don't know if you were like me, but sports was a big deal to me. I played every single sport, and there are so many days, right, where I was Eric Davis. If you don't know who that is, he was an outfielder for the Cincinnati Reds, or I was Davey Concepcion, my favorite shortstop, the number 13. Love that guy. And there weren't many days where I didn't, at some point, as I'm holding the baseball bat, right, I become Eric Davis as I hit a walk-off home run, right? And the crowd goes wild. I don't know how many of you were like that as a child, but as I'm out there in the field all by myself, in my imagination, I hit a home run over the fence, even though there was no fence, right? And I say to myself, I even say out loud, and the crowd goes wild. There aren't many days where I was on the basketball court, and I am, as time expires, I am Dr. J, right? And I'm skying above everybody, maybe even doing a 360 dunk, and the buzzer goes off. I love to play my heroes, right? Now, there was no fence for me to hit home run over, probably not even a baseball, or I just popped it up. But in my imagination, I was Eric Davis. Now, I would love to tell you that the rim was 10 foot tall, and there were many defenders as I skied over them to dunk, but I lowered the rim to 6 feet. That was the only way I was going to be able to be the hero that day. For me, in those moments, right, I was the hero. We all love playing the hero, don't we? We all love playing the hero. On our way home from Florida the other day, somewhere around 11 p.m., the low tire pressure light blinked on. And so I thought, well, this happens, you know, this just happens. As you're traveling a long ways, you lose a little bit of pressure, and then those stupid sensors in your tires, I don't know why we have those things. We didn't used to have those things, but anyway, we have them now, and that thing goes off, and I'm like, oh, man, I want to press through. Our plan was to drive through the night. We wanted to get home 7 o'clock in the morning. It was going to be great. That tire light comes on, and I have a dilemma. I have to think, okay, do I press on, or do I do the responsible thing as a husband, as a dad, and stop and check it out? You know what I did? I did the responsible thing, and I stopped, and we stopped at the next exit, and I go out, and I look, and one of the tires was a little bit low, and I'm like, oh, that's no big deal. I can fix this, right? I just put air in it. Well, I don't know what it is with my van, but I went to put air in it, and as the air hit the valve stem, it blew off a piece of metal, right? It's like aluminum, and it's like this nut that goes over the valve stem, and if you don't have that thing, evidently, air will just come out. And so I'm like, that's okay. In my mind, I'm like, I can save this. We're still going to get home. I go into the truck stop, and I'm finding that little nut. I'm going to put that back on, and we're going to be on the road, and we're going to be home, and it's going to be awesome. I go in there, and they don't have those things in the truck stop, right? I even look around, and I'm like, okay, I can still do this. And I look for tire shops around. I'm like, if there was still one open, or maybe, just maybe, there's an emergency roadside service I can call. They can bring that thing to me. We can fix a tire, and we'd be on our road. And I'm thinking and thinking, I can figure this out. I even get air, and I'm like, okay, if I hold the valve stem as tight as I can, I push the air in there, I'll get air in the tire, and we'll be okay. So I'm leaning down, and I'm putting this in. And nothing. I can't get it. And then the voice of reason, aka my wife, she says, Rob, maybe we just need to get a hotel. Perhaps God is trying to save us from something. And I'm like, great, pull the God card. How do I say no to that, right? So we go into this nasty hotel. And we stay there for the night. Kids didn't mind. They just slept through the whole thing. But anyway, I just kept thinking in my head all night long. I couldn't sleep. I'm like, how am I going to make this? How am I going to win here, right? Anyway, we ended up getting back on the road after sitting in a tire shop for 4 hours in the morning. But we want to be the hero. I wanted to be the hero. I wanted to win. Now, if I were to ask you, who is your favorite hero, who would you say? In fact, I want you to turn to your neighbor, and I want you to tell them your favorite hero. Who is your hero? Take 20 seconds and tell them who that is. Now, most likely, there were a number of different people just mentioned. You know, in a room this size, this many people, there's probably many heroes that had just been talked about. I mean, it could be Superman, right? The Man of Steel, totally could be him. I know my son would say Flash, right? That is his favorite. Speed, that's what it's all about. Maybe you said Wonder Woman, maybe Thor. Maybe Iron Man, maybe some of you thought of other different shows or movies and you're like Luke, not Luke Duke, Luke, like the Jedi, right? Or maybe Yoda, or maybe for some of you who remember this guy, I've heard of him before, it's John Wayne, right? I don't know that I've seen a John Wayne movie, but I have seen many Chuck Norris movies, right? He's a hero, right? He's tougher than anyone. Others of you might have gotten a little more personal and said, my dad is my hero. Or maybe my grandma's my hero. Or maybe, guys, you did the smart thing and you turned to your wife with loving eyes and said, babe, you're my hero. Maybe, though, you realized, wait a minute, I'm in church. Jesus has to be the right answer, right? That has to be Jesus. And where I'm not always in favor of church answers, you're right. It is Jesus. He is the hero. And today, without trying not to be too trite, I want to talk about reasons. I want us to consider a few reasons why Jesus gets hero status. Thinking of your chosen hero, there's so many reasons why you considered them your favorite. I mean, what did they do to get hero status in your book? Man, I do think there's a lot of commonalities when it comes to heroes. There's a lot of things that play out across all heroes, but I want to tell you, there's a big difference between most of the heroes that we just mentioned and Jesus. See, our fantasy heroes don't really exist. Right? I mean, Flash isn't real, right? Batman is just a man who's rich. They don't really exist, and they can't make a difference in your life. I mean, sports heroes are fun to watch, but there is no chance that we're going to have a meaningful relationship with them. I mean, if I stop at a gas station and Peyton Manning happens to be there, who I love Peyton Manning, but if I asked him to hang out that day, I don't think we're going to have coffee, right? You can't have a meaningful relationship with your sports heroes. Jesus, however, is the hero of all time. He is the one that we can connect with on a daily basis. He knows your deepest thoughts. He knows your heart. He is the one who paid the ultimate price for redemption, our salvation. He promises to keep us safe and care for us. He won't be defeated, and he has defeated our enemies. I imagine if Jesus was on the Avengers, the conversation might look a little bit like this. And that's how I saved the world, right? See, when we try to be our own hero, we always butt up against our own limitations. We're finite creatures. And ultimately, no matter how much we try to deny it, we're fundamentally needy. We're needy. The fact is, we are unable to be all that we want to be. we are completely dependent on an outside source, on something else or someone else. We depend on grace from outside of ourselves. And where does that grace come from? It comes from Jesus. That grace comes from Jesus. More specifically, that grace comes from Jesus' fullness. His fullness. John 1:16 puts it like this: from his fullness, we have all received grace upon grace. Grace upon grace. We have received out of Jesus' fullness, grace upon grace. Let me explain it by talking about an amazing story out of John chapter 2. It's the wedding in Cana. Now, it's written that the bridegroom or the husband, right, the groom in this situation, was on the brink of being seriously embarrassed. His need becomes obvious when he runs out of wine, which is a serious faux pas at a Jewish wedding during that time. And leave it to Jesus' mom. She was like, hey, I'll take care of this. I'm going to get Jesus involved. And so she says, Jesus, you need to do something about this. You know what's getting ready to happen. People are going to start to get angry. Can you do this? And Jesus is like, oh, mom, you know, I don't want to do this. You know, it's not my time. But he reluctantly agreed, and he asked the servants, I want you to fill these 6 stone jars with water. I want you to fill them with water, which he immediately transformed into wine. Right, the water turned into wine. And it wasn't just any wine. It was like the best wine. In fact, the guy in charge of the whole ceremony, he even had to comment about it. He said, now, most of the time, people bring out the cheap wine at the end, but you bring out the best wine at the end. Because Jesus had transformed it into the best possible wine. And how much wine does he make? Well, those stone jars were huge, right? They said they hold in between 20 and 30 gallons, and there's 6 of them. So let's call that 25 gallons each, 150 gallons total, which if you filled wine bottles would be 900 bottles of wine. That's a crazy amount. But I think it paints an amazing picture of Jesus. See, life with Jesus is one of overflowing grace. Ridiculous fullness that can't be contained. That out of Jesus' fullness, he gives us grace upon grace upon grace. And I don't know about you, I have messed up enough times in my life where I have needed more and more and more grace. Jesus gives out of his fullness. And I want you to catch this. What does that mean? It means that my emptiness, my neediness, my obvious limitations just don't matter. In fact, it's as we recognize our weaknesses that we put ourselves in a position to receive the grace that God wants to give us. It's in our weaknesses. It's in our limitations. It's in those things that we just can't seem to get right that we are poured over with grace upon grace upon grace. I want you to think of your limitations for a minute. I want you to think of your weaknesses. Let's consider that we're in a job interview situation, and what do they always ask you? What are your strengths, which you're always kind of embarrassed to say, and what are your weaknesses? What is it for you? I want you to name them. Name it in your head. What is your weakness? If you need to write it down, write it down. What is your weakness? And I want you to hold on to that as we look at another reason Jesus gets hero status. I don't know about you, but when things suddenly get out of control in my life, I can lose control. Just like that lovable green hero that we call the Hulk, my blood can start to boil and something unhealthy can come out. Now, I know it's not to a great extent, but the other night in the tire situation, as I am sitting, I'm kneeling down 11 o'clock at night in the rain, right? In the rain, this bald head, it's not good in the rain. But I'm kneeling down and I'm trying to put air in it and it's just not working and I'm just realizing that I can't do this. I don't know what I'm gonna do. So you know what happens? I punch the tire like 6 times. The good thing is tires are made of rubber and it bounces back every time. I can't say that's always been the case when I have taken my frustrations out on something. There might have been a few holes in walls. Mostly just damaged knuckles. But something inside comes out when suddenly my control is lost. There's a day in Mark chapter 5 where the evening before had already been somewhat chaotic. Jesus and his disciples had just gone through a traumatic experience, or at least it was traumatic for the disciples. They were on their boat and they were traveling, and all of a sudden this huge storm hits. And their boat is being tossed. They feel like they're gonna die. And the only person that could really do anything about it was asleep in the back of the boat, Jesus. So obviously their fear like came up to the surface. Right? Their fear comes up and it just wells up in them and it starts to come out and they're like, what are we gonna do? But we know that Jesus wakes up calmly. He says, stop. The waves stop. The wind quits blowing because he has power over the elements. His power was greater than their fear. Now, right after that, as they dock their boats near a graveyard, they're immediately greeted by a man who actually lives there among the tombstones. Right, the locals were terrified of them. All night they could hear him screaming like a zombie, where they would go in there and he'd be cutting himself with rocks. They even tried to subdue him. They even tried to chain him up and put shackles on his ankles and his wrists, and he like had superhuman strength where he broke free almost as if those shackles were made of string. As Jesus and his disciples approached, this man seems to recognize Jesus. And he runs to him. He throws himself down and begs for mercy. He claims to be possessed by an army of demons. They call themselves Legion. Now imagine what the disciples were thinking, right? They had just seen Jesus calm the waves. And now that he is approached by this man, I'm sure they were just thinking, what fireworks are next, right? Like, what is he going to do now? And he speaks directly to the demon. He speaks directly to the demons and commands them to come out of that man and gives them permission to enter into this herd of pigs, which everybody watched as they ran down a hill over a cliff to their death in the sea below. See, what was inside that man, those demons, had to come out. And Jesus showed his power over what was inside that man. I'm not going to get into the possibilities of people being possessed by demons. That's a different conversation for a different day. But I do understand this. We all have an inner voice. We all have something inside of us that is constantly talking to us. And in a culture where we're constantly comparing ourselves to other people, we see someone and we'll say, I wish I was like them. it's easy for us to listen to that voice, that inner voice that tells us you're not good enough. It's easy for us to listen to the voice that says, remember what you did back there? Remember what you did to them? Do you remember who you used to be? You will never be good enough. No one will ever love you. We listen to that voice. And that voice can take over our lives. I had a conversation on the way back from Florida from a friend of mine. And he called and he's crying. And he says, I need to talk. And I'm like, what's going on? And he says, I'm in the behavioral wing of the hospital. I'm like, what's going on? He says, I couldn't take it anymore. His fiance had just adopted a few kids, actually just like fostering the kids, and he's feeling lonely. You know what you think? That's not that big of a deal, right? But when that voice in your heart and in your head just starts telling you, she doesn't love you, she doesn't love you, she doesn't want to be with you, he started to believe it to the point where he's like, I don't know if I want to live anymore. What's that voice inside can take over? It seems to be so strong. So looking at those two stories, what inner voice is trying to take over? I want you to name it. Name your Hulk. Name that the thing inside that keeps telling you that you're not good enough. Write it down if you have to. Is it fear of what you can't control? Is it your desire to be like whoever, fill in the blank? Is it the mistakes that you made, or the evil or the sin that is in your past? Is it depression? Is it suicidal thoughts? What is it? Name it. And hold on to it as we get to this last one. Jesus has hero status because he gives out of his fullness. He has hero status in my book because he helps tame my inner Hulk. And finally, Jesus has hero status because the hero Jesus becomes a hero maker. Becomes a hero maker. You know, we've just been through Holy Week, right? It's a big week in the life of the church. Starting with Palm Sunday, right? We have Maundy Thursday, and we have Good Friday, and Easter Sunday, and Egg Hunt Saturday. I don't know. But for me, thinking of the whole week, the one that always hits me the hardest is Good Friday. I don't know about you, but that's the one that always hits me the hardest, that always seems to make such a big impact on me. I remember as a kid, and my parents would be like, you know, we're going to the Good Friday service. And I'm like, Good Friday? What's so good about this Friday, right? I mean, this is the day that Jesus dies. Why are we celebrating Good Friday? Why do we even call it Good Friday? Let me tell you, Good Friday is the day that we remember the cross. Good Friday is when we remember that Jesus died the death that we deserved, taking the punishment that was ours upon himself so that we could be free. Good Friday is where God's justice was satisfied so that I can receive the not guilty verdict when I stand before the throne of God. Romans 4:25 says, he was delivered over to death for our sins. We have to understand what Good Friday means. It's exciting. It's an amazing day because it is the day that set me free. So if we look at such an important event in history, Jesus' death, the day that holds the hope that anyone can be forgiven, that no one has to be in bondage to their sins, the day that sins were taken away, why do we talk so much about Easter? Why do we talk so much about Easter? I mean, let's be honest. Has Easter become the day where I get new clothes and get dressed up and come to church because that's what I should do? I don't know about you, but when I was a kid, there's three boys. Easter meant that my mom was going to dress us the same. It was awful, right? I even have a picture of my mom making suits for us. I wish I had it. It's bad. Not that she's bad making, well, she dresses the same and I hated it, right? Has Easter become the day where you go and have a great meal with your family? Has Easter become about the joy that we get as we see our kids run out into that field and collect plastic eggs filled with candy? See, it was on Good Friday that the price for my sin was paid in full. But without Easter, without Easter Sunday, that Good Friday, that day becomes a mere transaction. Let me explain. When I go to the coffee shop and I say, I would like a venti Americano, they tell me it is $2.43 and I give them my money, they give me a cup of coffee. It's a transaction, right? We do it every single day. Without Easter Sunday, it is just a transaction. Jesus paid the price and we received eternity. It's just a transaction. I mean, it sounds kind of obvious when you spell it out, but without Easter Sunday, Jesus would still be dead. And my friends, you know why we're here today? Because Jesus isn't dead, that he is alive, he has risen, and he stands before the throne of God pleading our case. And through his gift of the Holy Spirit, he is with us still today. Easter Sunday shows that Jesus was victorious over sin and Satan, that death could not hold him because he defeated sin once and for all. And I want you to understand this. I want you to understand this. He defeated death. He is risen. Jesus is now lifted above every power, every authority. He rules as king over every nation, every tribe, every tongue. Jesus deserves the allegiance of every creature in existence, whether on earth or in heaven. That's Jesus. That's our hero. But I think he goes one step further than that. There's a passage in Matthew that we read all the time. I felt like we read it almost every week. But it's called the Great Commission. And here in Matthew chapter 28, it says, "And all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age." We talk about that middle section of that passage all the time. That we are to go, that we are to make disciples, that we are to baptize and be baptized, and we're supposed to teach people everything that we have been taught. And those are so important, so important. But I want you to know that middle section means nothing without the beginning and the end. The middle section of that passage doesn't mean anything without the bookends. Jesus starts with, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples." You can make disciples of anything and anyone, but with the authority and the power that Jesus gives us, you can change their lives. And he ends that with, I am with you always to the end of the age. That he is here. Because of Resurrection Sunday, Jesus is alive. He is risen. He is here. Which totally changes the way I read this passage that Paul writes in Ephesians chapter 1. He says this. I want you to listen. I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which he has called you, the riches of his glorious inheritance in his holy people, and his incomparably great power for those, for us who believe. That power is the same as the mighty strength he exerted when he raised Christ from the dead and seated him at the right hand in the heavenly realms.
Christ is risen from the dead, trampling over death by death. Come awake, come and rise up from the grave. Christ is risen from the dead, we are one with him again. Come awake, come and rise up from the grave.
Something from the story that we talked about with Legion. You know, when Jesus and the disciple entered that graveyard, what did we see? that man noticed Jesus, knew who he was, ran to him, threw himself down. My guess is he had had enough. He'd had enough. And my question is to you, have you had enough? Is there a chance that you've been sleepwalking through this life, shackled by your fear, by those things you can't control, being shackled by that inner voice? Is there a chance that you need to throw yourself down at the feet of Jesus and just say, I'm tired. I have to let go and allow God to give you grace upon grace upon grace. I want you to notice in that passage again, it says, his incomparable great power is available to those who believe. That power is the same power that raised Jesus from the dead. And he says, I am giving you that power. See, what we see in Jesus is that he's not just our hero, he makes us into heroes. The power to calm the storm, to release the captives.